got out what all my friends said. Can't get you out of my head. Oh, 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 oh. I keep letting you in, though I know it's not a good thing. I got you under my skin. Oh, 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 oh.
Welcome back to Inside the Women's Game, the podcast. We are back with the first of two episodes dropping this week. Joining me in the first of this week's special episodes is none other than Reading's defensive ace, Molly Bartrip. Hello, Molly. Good evening. I hope you're keeping well back there.
I am. I'm doing all right, as you can, really, in these times. But yeah, I'm good, thank you. Hope you are.
Yeah, not too bad. It's a difficult time for everyone at the moment, obviously, isn't it? Away from the pitch, just how have you been keeping yourself occupied? I know you're still lucky enough to be in training every single day. That must be pleasing.
Yeah, we're lucky, really. Fortunate, because there's so many people out there that aren't allowed to do their jobs, you know, and go and do the kind of their normal life. But yeah, we've got to kind of take it as a positive, because we are being allowed to go and do what we love at the moment. So yeah, apart from football, like, what can you do at the end of the day? Like, Netflix, you know, watching all the men's games, doing, that's all you can do, really. But I tend to keep myself occupied quite easily.
So let's take you back to the weekend, if we could, Molly. Obviously, a hard-fought 2-2 draw away at Aston Villa in very difficult conditions, as the snow just got heavier and heavier in the second half. I know you were all disappointed. We spoke about this before coming here, about how deflating the draw was. Just how would you assess the game overall?
Frustrating. You know, you go and draw to a team like Arsenal, we've drawn to Man City, the big old teams in the league, and it's frustrating when you then go to a team that aren't as, let's be real, aren't as good as those teams, and you can't get the result you need. It's kind of been the sum up of our season, really. We need to score more goals, and we not need to stop conceding them. It's the way football works, isn't it, at the end of the day? But definitely frustrating. Obviously, the conditions were crazy. Don't think I've ever played in something like that before. But that's something new to, you know, put on the CV. But yeah, like, at the end of the day, it was a tough game, because we could have put the game to bed. We didn't, which allows naturally another team to just kind of regain confidence and then motivation to go and potentially, if they know if they can score, that they're back in the game, you know. And that's what we allowed them to do. And look, fair play to Villa for doing it, but we should have, that game should have been done in the first half, you know. And it's something we seriously need to work on going into the next few games.
Yeah, I think despite the result, there are lots of positives to take. Obviously, the way you played in the first half from an attacking point of view, the amount of possession you had in there inside their box. I know it's a bad result in terms of the actual scoreline, but in terms of positives you can take out of it, there's several there to take into the next match.
Oh, definitely. You know, we've done analysis, and there's some unbelievable possession at times. You know, we play the way any team wants to play, and it's just frustrating that it's not kind of had the end product. But as I said, we scored two goals. You know, like, that says it all, really. Most Premier League teams, other teams in WSL, score two goals, you've won the game. Yeah. Unfortunately for us, that didn't happen. But yeah, you're right. There was positives to take from it, like our calmness around the back, the way we bought into the midfield, even some of the through balls that the midfielders play. Like you've got class players in there, so you know they'll do that with their eyes closed. But yeah, as I said, there's positives to take. But again, the main thing is, there's, for me, you look at results and you want 3 points. So you can be all, yeah, like, we did really well with these things. But at the end of the day, you want 3 points on the board, and we didn't get that.
Absolutely. And in terms of the current campaign, it's been a it's been a steady season so far. Like you said, some good results against Arsenal, in particular Manchester City, who scored 14 goals in the last two games. That just shows how well they're playing. And to get a draw against such a top-level side like that, just how would you assess the season so far?
Yeah, exactly. Like, it's amazing because in previous years, you know, I've been here a long time. In previous years, we've not done that. I don't think ever got a result off Arsenal, which is crazy. And we did last weekend. Was it last weekend? Weekend before.
Yeah.
Again, we drew into Man City, massive with the players they've got and the standard that they're at the moment. We may be hitting them at a better time, you know, in comparison to these teams now. They're in full flow and they're smashing goals in left, right and centre. But we maybe we're playing them at a good time. But, you know, Arsenal, Chelsea, Man City, you can be playing them at a bad time, but they'll still beat teams. So for us to get a point of a team like that, where there was massive confidence, and it just proves to us that we can do it and we can compete with the best. We just now need to make sure we're beating the teams in and around us to get us back up the board again.
In terms of the WSL, just talk about the standard of play, because obviously there's so many top sides in there. And look at the league table. You're in a great position at the moment. And obviously, considering the teams that are in there, you must be really pleased with how you've performed during the season.
Yeah, look, we've had some great games. We've also had some tough games. And I think if you actually look at our season, it's been quite up and down. I think we would have liked to be a little bit higher than we are. You know, there's teams in and around us that have actually got games in hand. So you just don't know what's going to happen with those results. And you don't really want to risk having to, you know, wait on those results. You want to know that you've done your work and that's it. But yeah, look, we've done okay. I wouldn't say we've been spectacular because we've not done what really we wanted to do. But again, there's like 9 games left, I think. And really, that's a long way to go. We can change a lot in that. And I know we're working a lot harder on the training pitch to stop all the little things that keep happening quite consistently. So we can only get better. And that's the aim at the end of the day.
So let's just talk a bit about your football journey, Molly, about where your journey all started. You started playing at a very young age, didn't you? Have you always been into football, or just how did a dream of a career in football all turn into reality for you?
Yeah, I didn't really do anything else growing up. It was all football, any sport really. I just threw myself at it. My parents were so good with me, you know. I'm quite fortunate actually, they're both really sporty, so I was kind of only going to fall into it really. I remember 6 years old, I think I was, and I just went straight into a team and I loved it, playing with boys, you know, like, yeah, I loved playing with boys. It was probably the highlight of my career, really. Experiencing, you know, like, they're not like women, they're completely different. And I think that probably for a lot of females at the moment, that probably is the difference between some that have played with boys and haven't. But yeah, like, I was really fortunate growing up. My parents did everything for me, really, took me anywhere I needed to go. And I kind of said yes to anything, any sport, and I've been really fortunate that football was the kind of the one that I fed into, and I'm still playing now. So yeah.
So at the age of 9, you signed for Tottenham Hotspur, obviously your first big club. Just talk us through how all that came about. Obviously playing with the boys, and then you signed for Tottenham Hotspur. That was a massive move for you.
Yeah, it was, especially when you're a West Ham fan. It's not the best move. My dad wasn't too happy. I was playing for a boys' team and got scouted. And they said, I think at that time I was allowed to play Saturday and Sunday. So I was playing on Monday the boys and Monday the girls. And that's kind of like how it worked for me until I basically moved to Charlton. But yeah, I loved being and playing with girls because it kind of tested you to where actually you should be at. You know, with boys, they were naturally stronger and quicker than me. But at least with girls, I could kind of realise where I was in comparison to the better players. And yeah, I had a really great couple of years at Spurs. And like, it's mad because at that time, I don't think they were actually in the academy. But now you look at them, they're in WSL and they're a completely different team. So yeah. It was an experience for me, and it was a different team that I played for. And as much as I hated wearing that kit, it's something that I did, you know, when I was younger, and it's kind of made me the player I am now. So yeah.
So after gaining that experience at Tottenham at a very young age, you moved on to Charlton. But was it your time at the under-12s at Arsenal when you really started to think, wow, I'm really doing well for myself here, break into the academy, training partly and playing with the first team? Now that must have really made you think that, wow, I can really do this.
Yeah, Arsenal was massive for me. they were definitely one of the best academies growing up. Centre of Excellence is what they used to call it. And when I got asked to go to Arsenal, it was the biggest shock because I didn't really see myself as somebody that would be that good to go there. I just played football because I loved it, you know. And when I got to Arsenal, it was kind of like I was playing with these good players, like the best in the country, to be honest. The likes of Leah Williamson, Carla Humphrey, I played with all of these growing up, and like you look at them now and they've gone on to massive things. So we had a really talented young group at Arsenal, and yeah, we kind of all followed each other really through 12s, 14s, 16s, and some of us went to the academy and lived there and was obviously doing the education side too. And then I got my chances to train with the first team in the evenings, and that was just a different level, you know. Like I remember going to training, it was like Kim Little, who I still admire to this day, unbelievable footballer, and I was like, whoa. You know, she's class. I just remember giving her the ball and hoping she did the rest. But yeah, look, I've been really fortunate, if I'm honest, to have gained those experiences and been able to kind of see the players. And I had a lot of role models growing up, but Kelly Smith was one of them. And I remember being in the same change room as her once, and it was like literally sitting next to your idol, you know. And yeah, like those kind of things are little things that make you realise why you want to play football and why you want to go and do what they've done. You know, I'm not going to do what Kelly Smith has done to the women's game, but I can go and be a professional, you know. And I think the biggest step for me was obviously having to leave Arsenal and make the decision to move on.
So let's just talk a bit more about Arsenal. Obviously, in terms of the women's game, one of the biggest clubs in world football, just how was the whole experience? You must have learnt a great deal from the older players. I know that my first two guests, Lee and Lily, obviously played with the likes of Rachel Yankee in training. I mean, Rachel Yankee for me, not just as a player, but as a pundit now, she's so knowledgeable. She is an ambassador for women's football. And it must be great to play alongside players like that.
Absolutely. Like, yeah, as I said, like Lily was obviously in the academy. Lee went on and did some stuff with the first team as well. So like to experience that at such a young age, it was amazing, to be fair. Like, again, like you only kind of have to compare yourself to those players, and that's where you want to be at. You know, I think even Jordan Nobbs was there when I was there, and she was so young at the time, but she was well known, you know, within Arsenal, and that's somebody you look up to because they've gone through the same pathway that you have. And I think that was the main thing, is you kind of look at the players that have gone through a pathway and it's like, well, if they've done it, let me try, you know. And I wasn't fortunate enough to make that full move into the first team of Arsenal, but I was fortunate enough to have experienced what I wanted to do and to play again Yank's unbelievable person and player. Kelly Smith, exactly the same. And to kind of be in and around people like that, you're only going to gain a massive experience and knowledge of football.
So after Arsenal, around 7 years ago or so, you joined Reading, a club obviously which is still at now. You've been there 7-8 years now. Firstly, just how did the move to the Medeski first come about?
So at Arsenal, Jane Ludlow was playing and she ended up retiring and actually became the Reading manager. So she took the likes of me, Lauren Bruton, Lee, across to Reading. My natural thought was, I want to play, and I want to play first team football. And Jane offered me that chance. It was a big risk because I'm from Essex, you know, it's the other side of London going to Reading. I was away from my family at such a young age. So it was a big life decision for me, but one that I needed to make because I knew I wasn't necessarily going to get the fair chance that I wanted at Arsenal. So I kind of had to make that decision naturally, and definitely the best decision I made. Jane was probably the best coach I've ever worked under. Got the best out of me in every single way on and off the pitch. And yeah, she was a dream to work under, if I'm completely honest. I know Lee probably spoke about it as well. Like, she was great. Crazy, but the best. And it was a no-brainer for me to go with her to Reading. And yeah, I'm still here. So yeah, something went right.
Yeah, when I spoke to Lee last week, she was saying she wasn't just a good coach on the pitch, but off the pitch, she could have a laugh with the players. And she found that balance between having a laugh and taking it seriously and a game head on. Obviously, she's left her post now as Wales manager, so it won't be long. I don't think she'll be out of a job very long. She'll be back in a job within no time at all in the WSL, hopefully.
Absolutely. Like, she's such a good person, people person. She knows football in and out. I mean, it's not going to take long for a club to snap her up. Absolutely not. But just a great person. Still to this day, yeah, like whenever I'd see her, I'd always say hello and have a chat. And she's somebody that I massively respect and owe a lot to.
So as I say, after just over 7 years at a fantastic club in Reading, you must have so many great stories and you've shared the pitch with so many fantastic players.
Yeah, I have. I really have when I think about it. You know, Fran being the biggest one, probably. I remember coming and I didn't know it. I didn't know Fran going to my first training session. I had no idea who the girl was. And like, until people were like, oh yeah, she's in the England setup. And I was like, oh right, okay. I then seen the first session and I was like, oh yeah, she's all right, you know. And to this day, Fran is one of my closest friends and will forever be one of my friends because she's just a great person. But as a footballer, I don't think I've ever seen anybody like it. So gifted, but natural. So playing with Fran, unbelievable. Farah, for me, has been a massive part of kind of me growing up as a person, really. Sitting next to her in a change room was a shock, I tell you that. But again, just an amazing person and individual and somebody I admire so much in all that she's done. Joe Potter, Jade Moore, you know, like there's just so many that I've been fortunate enough to play with. But even this year with Jess Fishlock, you know, massive player, huge, done so many things in her career that I'd only wish to do. And you can only gain so much knowledge from those kind of players and being around them. And I'm really lucky to call some of them my friends.
So just speaking a bit more about Fran there, you must be really pleased with your former teammate and obviously a good friend. Finding a feat at Chelsea like she has done. I mean the hat trick she scored the other week, the perfect hat trick, left foot, right foot, and a headed effort. It was against yourselves, but obviously on a personal note, you must have been pleased with her form and the way she's playing. It must have been difficult, obviously, playing against Fran, and obviously she scored a hat trick against you, so that must have been difficult to take. But then again, you must be after the game, obviously, congratulating her.
At the end of the day, she's gone and scored a hat trick, but it's nothing more than what Fran deserves because honestly, never met somebody so humble and loving in my life. You know, she's just a great person. And as I said, probably the most talented player, I think, personally in the league, the one with the most potential to go into massive things. And she's not exactly old, you know, like she's still got so much more left in her career. And I think she is in form at the moment and people are seeing that. And it's so nice to see somebody like her get the attention that she fully deserves. But yeah, I've been really fortunate to be close to Fran through her whole, you know, career since leaving Reading. And yeah, it's nothing more than the girl deserves.
Yeah, I mentioned that particular game. It must have been difficult for Fran, I expect, as well. Obviously, Reading plays a big part in her career and she's got a heart and soul into Reading still. I know she's at Chelsea now, but she's Reading is part of who she is. And that must have been difficult. I know she's got a hat-trick. It must have been difficult to sort of keep all those emotions in.
Yeah, absolutely. Of course. Like, I mean, probably 5 years prior, maybe 6 years prior, she scored at the Majewski for Reading, you know, which is crazy when you think about it. And it is her hometown. It's where her family are. And look, it would have been tough. But at the end of the day, her job is to play football for Chelsea and score goals. And that's what she did in the game. And you can't take anything away from her. You know, she's a class footballer and she proved that day. You know, I actually was on the bench for that game and I witnessed that. And it doesn't surprise me with Fran. Nothing ever surprises me with her.
So in terms of scoring goals, just how is it to have Farah Williams in your corner, a fantastic player and a fantastic person with all that experience? Has she helped guide you for your career?
Oh, no. Farah's one of my role models since I was a kid. It was her and Kenny Smith for me. And when she turned up at Reading, it was like a breath of fresh air. Somebody so knowledgeable, but so humble. Like an MBE, but you'd never know, you know? Like she's just Farah. A princess, but the best princess you'll ever see, you know, like she's just a great person and somebody that I really do look up to and respect massively. What she's done in her career is amazing. But yeah, as you're on the pitch, you know, some of the goals she's scored for us have been ridiculous. you know, sometimes you're like, I need Farah, like we need Farah to score, because sometimes you just think, where else are we going to score at the moment? Farah is the one that does these things out of completely nothing. It's just magic. And I'm lucky I get to see that every day in training, you know, like it's not just a fluke. I can tell you that Farah does it every day. And that's why she's the person she is and the player she is at the end of the day. But yeah, I mean, anybody is lucky if they have Farah in their team.
I suppose it helps when all her experience she has, that when the girls are feeling deflated or down in a particular moment in a game, she's there to pick the girls up.
Absolutely. Yeah, she's just a great character to have around, so positive, and she doesn't stop talking. But yeah, look, she's just a great character, and yeah, we've had ups and downs this season, and she's always there, you know, full of knowledge, full of wisdom, and just basically tells you like the right and wrong things, really. And I think like whenever she says something, I'm the first to listen, because look what she's done in her career. You can't not listen to somebody that's gone and done stuff like that.
So let's just talk a bit about representing your country, if we could, Molly. Obviously, playing for England at every single youth level, it must be such an amazing feeling stepping out in the famous shirt and representing your country. Can you remember your first match for England? It must have been a surreal feeling for you.
Absolutely. Yeah, I was really young. I think 14, maybe. Really young. And I had my family there, and it was a massive experience for me. Something, again, I never thought I would ever get. There's nothing better than singing the national anthem at the end of the day. It was a massive, massive thing for me, because since I was a kid, that's all I wanted to do was play for England. You know, every young girl that loves football is, I want to play for England, you know. And to have experienced that, at not just, you know, under 15s, but all the way up to under 23s, was something I'm very fortunate to have had an experience. But yeah, at the end of the day, like, football is football, and you go on, whether you're in an England shirt, a Reading shirt, a Chelsea shirt, a West Ham shirt, it doesn't matter who you are, you play at the end of the day, and you've got a job to do. And I was lucky to go to many different countries of football, so many different countries that I know for a fact that I would never have gone to unless it was for England. So yeah, again, it's given me that kind of experience of life, different countries, different cultures. And I'm really fortunate, to be fair, that I got those chances. Not many do, you know. To say that you've played for England through the youth age groups is something that I'll always be able to say for the rest of my life. Tell my kids, my grandkids, you know, like that's something I can say forever. So it's, yeah, obviously an amazing experience for anybody that gets that chance.
It must be amazing, though, that at that age, when all your mates are going to school on a Monday morning, you're saying, right, I'm off to Moldova now playing for England. It must just be an amazing feeling, and as you say, memories.
Yeah, full of memories. And I think a couple of weeks ago, I got my caps. And it's just something you can treasure forever, you know. But yeah, again, like, I've been to LA with England. Like, who would say wow. That? Belgium, just random, Israel, like really random places that I know I probably would never have gone on holiday anyway. But I experienced that, and with some great girls as well, you know, friends that I'm still lucky to be with right now. And yeah, I met some great, great people along the way, played with some amazing people along the way as well, you know, some that are in the seniors now. So something that I will definitely treasure forever, as you said, and something that will stay with me.
So life on and off the pitch hasn't always been straightforward for you, has it, Molly? Obviously, you've had your battles, and something that you've been very open about. Just talk us through what you had to go through and just how you battled through those times, working extremely hard to get to where you are today.
Yeah, I was diagnosed with anorexia when I was 14. I was at Arsenal, actually, and they were unbelievable with it. So supportive. I loved food, if I'm honest, when I was younger. And it was a shock to not just me, but my whole family and friends. Something I never really experienced and never knew about growing up. I didn't really learn anything about it. So I didn't really know how to deal with it. Something that, yeah, will stick with me forever, unfortunately. But something that I think I've come stronger from, you know. It's something that not many people even recover from. So the fact that I did was a massive, massive thing for me. It took a while, you know, the small steps that you have to take, but I had amazing people around me, and I couldn't have done it without them for sure. And I've experienced depression and anxiety, and realistically still kind of suffer from anxiety now, but depression was pretty bad a couple of years ago. And it, yeah, again, another thing that you have to go through, but I got through the other side again somehow, and it's something that I'm really proud to say that I did. But I have like full admiration for anybody that goes through anything like that, because it's tough. It is fully tough. Sometimes you don't even feel like yourself, and to kind of wake up every day and not know who you are is really, really different, and it's hard to kind of accept, really. But again, as I said, I had amazing people around me that kind of kept me fighting, kept me going, and really kept me alive. So yeah, I've had some tough times, take it that way. But look, I'm who I am now because of it. I think I'm a lot more humble and a lot more kind of understanding now than I was before, because I've had those experiences, and I think they're only going to help me in the future.
Obviously, being a mental health sufferer myself, and depression and anxiety and stuff like that, it's, unless you've had it and been there, it's very difficult to for other people on the from the outside to understand just what goes on, because it's just, I don't know, like you say, you just don't feel yourself, and that's just how it can, as I say, if you've not had it, then it's difficult to sort of put it into context of the way it makes you feel.
Yeah, it is. It's really hard. And I had psychologists, I had counsellors, and to try and help me the way, like, through it, still speak to my psychologist to this day, you know, she's got me through a lot. And, but yeah, as you said, it's really hard to kind of even explain it to some people, because not many people understand it unless they've experienced something like that. But it sounds mad, but I'm kind of thankful I've experienced it, because it now, I'm not really afraid of anything that's going to hit me anymore, because I know I've had some tough times and some real lows that only things can get better from now on. And that's how I try and keep that positive mindset, because I'm normally the most negative person in the world. So that's how I try and keep myself positive, knowing that I've been through the tough times and there's only going to be positive times from now on. But yeah, as you said, it's really hard to kind of even explain it to somebody. You know, the first step is talking, but sometimes it's so hard to like start that initial chat. And I completely respect, again, anybody that is going through or has gone through it, because it's something that's, it's so tough, it's so mentally draining, like to wake up and actually lift your head off the pillow, you know. It's really hard. So yeah, as I said, it's something that not people aren't gonna get better overnight. It's not a light switch moment, but it's something that I still believe it will be with me for the rest of my life. I still feel like I know that I'm always going to be kind of like prone to go in that way, because it's in me, but I also know that I've dealt with it before, so I can deal with it again.
So we spoke about your career up to this point, so what's next for you, Molly? Is it just a case of continuing to work hard, maintaining those very high standards that you set, and continue to help guide the club as far as you can?
Yeah, look, I've been here a long time. Do I know what's next? No, at the end of the day. Football is so hit and miss sometimes, and I'm excited to see what can happen, whether that's Reading, whether that's another club, I don't know. But I've been here a long time, you know, I've created some amazing memories here, and I'm looking forward to seeing what can happen next. But yeah, for me, individually, I just want to go and kick on, you know, I want to continue playing every week, because I need to. And at the end of the day, like, there's no limit. I just want to go and enjoy my football. And for me, like, the advice that I've been given growing up is, as long as you're happy, you know, as long as you're enjoying yourself and you're doing what you love. And if that's football for me. So wherever I am, I want to be happy. I don't really have any goals, if I'm completely honest. People will say, you know, do you want to go and do this? Do you want to go and do that? I just want to be happy. And that is probably from my experiences with mental health that's made me realise, as long as I'm happy, I really don't care where I am. And yeah, I don't know what's next. It's exciting, isn't it? Like, at the end of the day. But yeah, like, I've experienced some really positive things with so many different players that I can only kind of continue that. And hopefully, whether that's at Reading, whether that's another club, to kind of continue that and kind of help others as well. Like you said, you know, Emma Harris has just signed her first professional contract. Like, she's a great person, and I'd love to be able to help her with, you know, the future and what she can go and become, because she would be a very good player in the future. So yeah, I don't know. At the end of the day, I actually don't know.
Yeah, it's a bit of a revolving circle, really, isn't it? Obviously, you've been at the club since a young age, with the likes of Joel Potter and and Pharrell Williams helping guide you through the ranks from back then to you are now, and then you're providing that same sort of energy towards Emma, who's just signed her first professional contract today.
Yeah, I mean, I don't look at myself like, you know, Joe Potter and Pharrell Williams, because they are way above me in every category. But yeah, look, I've coached Emma when she was a real young kid. And it was a proud moment. You know, Bethan Roberts got her first full debut at the weekend against Aston Villa. Again, thoroughly deserved. And but those kids, I've grown up coaching. And for me, it was a proud moment to see both of them go and do some really big things this week. And it's something that I'd love to be able to help them with, you know, because I've had, again, tough times, and I can help them with the fact that football is not just a smooth run in, you know, it's very up and down. You lose, you win, you get dropped, you get injured. It's so hit and miss sometimes that you've got to be ready for that. And that is probably my advice for any young kid that signed their first contract or made a debut is, football's not going to be just positive from now, you know, it's going to be up and down. So just be ready, you know, have the people around you need and chat. The best thing is talk.
So we touched on representing England just a few minutes ago there. Just what would it mean to you to receive a full international call up? Is that something you're bothered about, or just how would that make you feel if you did receive that call up?
It's interesting because it's not really something I think about, if I'm completely honest. I don't think I'm at that level. I think that there are some amazing footballers in that England squad, and I don't really think I'm naturally on par with them. If I've got a call up, I would definitely not say no. You know, it's an amazing experience, and it's something I've genuinely have wanted since I was a young girl. But it's not something in my thoughts, because I have to concentrate solely on myself. I have to concentrate on performing every week and making a point, you know, and proving that I'm good enough for Reading, let alone England. You know, I just need to prove a point to myself and to Reading that I'm good enough to play every week. So to say that England's in my thoughts is probably not correct, because I don't really see myself there yet. I'm only 24 at the end of the day. I've still got a long time. But yeah, every kid says that they want to play for England growing up. Of course they do. But I'm solely focusing on myself.
Just talk me through, if you would, just how supportive your parents have been throughout your career. Obviously, you played at a high level from such a young age. Just how inspirational have they been towards you and your career?
My mum is my best friend. Take it that way. She's my person. She has been through absolutely everything with me. My dad has always been the football guy. You know, he's always been the one that's, you're not good enough, you need to do this. You know, my critic, to be fair. But it's probably made me why I'm such a perfectionist now is because of my dad. And it's actually helped me when I think about it. My parents growing up were amazing. They are my inspiration. And if I'm anything like them when I'm older, then I will be so happy, because they've given me so much. Probably too much, if I'm honest. So I need to repay them. You know, they've offered me and given me so much support through the years of me being an absolute mess at times, you know, and that's something I can only be thankful for. And I honestly love them so much. And yeah, at the end of the day, they are my inspiration and will forever be my inspiration.
So as the FAWSL Team of the Week was unveiled today, just how are you pleased here for Emma Mitchell and Jess Fishlock? Jess was superb at the weekend, getting in and behind the Villa back line with such ease in that dominant first half. Just how pleased are you for Emma and Jess?
It's not a surprise. They do it every week. You know, Jess is huge for us. Somebody that probably real football players know how good she is. You know, like, she just does the little things so well. So it's no surprise to me that she was in the Team of the Week. Same for Mitch, you know. Sorry, Emma. She does so much, and I naturally, obviously, have been playing next to her, and she's gone on, again, she's so experienced in what she does that I can only kind of learn off somebody like the both of them. But yeah, as I said, it's no surprise to me, because they do it, you know, every week in, week out, and it's easy for them sometimes. It does look too easy, and especially Jess. I admire her, because she, some of the stuff she does in games, I just have to applaud, and I'm stood behind her and I'm applauding it, but she's just great. I think she's been Team of the Week like quite a lot this season as well, and it is thoroughly deserved. The reason she came over was, you know, to play football. And she's gone and pretty much embarrassed some players in the league. You know, she's that good. She's definitely embarrassed me a few times in training. So, yeah, she's great. And she's both of them fully deserved, really.
Well, Molly, I must say it's been an absolute delight speaking to you today and sharing your stories with me. And I wish you all the best, obviously, for the rest of the season.
Thank you very much. Thanks for chatting.
So please don't forget to like this video, guys. Subscribe to the channel and we'll see you again on Saturday morning with this week's bonus episode with London City Lionesses boss Mel Phillips. And thanks once again to Molly for joining us this evening. It's been very enjoyable hearing Molly's stories, and we'll catch you again soon.
Shut out what all my friends said.